Greetings, I'm Stanley Alper with the American Dream. We'll hear from our guest in just a moment.
This is WGLS Rowan Radio.
Welcome back to the American Dream. I'm your host, Stanley Alper. Today we have in the house this brother I actually recently just met. Actually, we've seen him for the first time. And the wonderful thing about the technology these days, I'm actually seeing him remotely. So James Ellerbe. Okay, James, welcome to the American Dream.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Good. Now, I want you to kind of give the audience a little background, you know, where you're from, what you do, you know, just general background about yourself.
Well, I'm originally from North Jersey, Bergen County, to be exact. Currently migrated to Willenboro with my wife for 8 years, and currently working for a phone company in their fraud department. But my passion and love is poetry, spoken word, and I've been doing that for about 20 years, and Wow. It has taken me places that I never dreamed of. Traveling far as Montreal, Canada, and my words traveling as far as Compton, USA. So I'm definitely a lover of words, and they have done a tremendous work through me and for other people as well.
Very good. You know, I kind of sense that passion, even in the emails back and forth. It's kind of interesting how you can pick up a person's vibe like that, you know, without even talking to them. But you can tell when a person's passionate about something. You really can by the way they express it. Now, as far as your American dream goes, what exactly would be your American dream?
Well, it's just like, well, back in 2014, I started my own company. Not Enough Words, LLC. And I originally designed a company to distribute my books and, you know, any other poetry content. But it has developed with the aspirations of me creating a platform for poets like myself who don't have a vehicle or not sure of where they can go or where their words can take them. So to me, that's the American dream, is taking my passion to the next step where it becomes a platform for other people who want to pursue their dreams through words.
Okay, very, very good. I'm a kind of a lover of words too, in terms of writing and poetry and short stories and different things like that. I would say it started off as just a fluke as a young person, you know, just writing in school and participating in literary competitions and that kind of stuff. And it kind of evolved into actually as an extension of spiritual study and work, you know, that I've been doing over the years. And that's kind of, I guess, the shape of it right now, although it's morphed into business and other areas. But I would say the driving force right now is probably spiritual more than anything else. With you, you know, and you said some 20 years. I mean, how did you get started? I mean, what was the basis behind you getting into the writing and words?
I have a very, I would say, interesting story, because back in high school, I would say around freshman, even into sophomore year, I really couldn't stand poetry. I wasn't a reader as much back then. And it wasn't until I started to take creative writing courses as, you know, part of my class curriculum that a door opened. And originally I just started writing more like writing a diary. Well, that's what I thought. And it wasn't until a friend of mine got a hold of one of my work and said, you know, this is poetry, man. You're writing poetry. Mm. And I still didn't really consider myself a poet, Because I like to say that there's two experiences. There's one where a person writes poetry, and then there's another experience where that person identifies as being a poet. And so it wasn't until, I would say, roughly around senior year going into college that I accepted that title as a poet. Because I looked at myself, you know, I looked at the greats like Paul Laurence Dunbar, Maya Angelou, Nikki Giovanni, Sonia Sanchez, you know, and one of my favorite, you know, by far is Ameri Baraka. And I looked at them as the giants. I looked at them as my work, you know, never comparing to the work that they did. But you know, I didn't come to realize until later that it's not about what they have done in poetry. It's what I plan to do or I want to say through poetry. And that's what makes, you know, a poet, is what is your voice? What do you have to say? And then how you're going to say it. That's the key to poetry. And it wasn't until senior year, I was involved with the NAACP Youth Council in Bergen County, where the advisor said, I need you to do a poem for our Kwanzaa program. And this was the first time that I was given the assignment to write something that I'm passionate about. Whereas before, you know, I was writing for school and so forth. But this was like the first time that I had to really step out of my comfort zone and tap into a place that I normally wouldn't share on that level. And I did, and that changed everything for me. That really was the turning point in my life, because then I say, okay, I have now a responsibility to say what I have to say for the people that need it said. So, and then, you know, voila, here I am.
You know, it's interesting that, because I know for most people, creative people, I mean, at least my experience is you do start off kind of in yourself, in your own space, and then something from the outside makes it click. And I, you know, I've been an artist my whole life, you know, drawing in elementary school. And I know for me, what happened was the people or students around me would be kind of ooh and ah by my drawings. And that kept me going. You know, I didn't really see myself as an artist. It was like, oh, this is cool. They like it.
You know? Exactly.
It wasn't until later on that I realized, okay, I'm an artist. I'm an artist now, you know, and that was kind of, I guess, my senior year in high school. But then even with the writing, was pretty much the same thing. And my story is a little different than yours, because I started writing, it was love letters to a girl I like. and it morphed into poetry. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like, okay, and you know, seeing that people were responding to the poetry, again, it was like, okay, this is something that people like. You know, they like my writing. And then it kind of went to, oh, why don't you participate in this literary magazine or this competition here? Why don't you perform? And I'm like, okay, all right. And I don't even think after the performing that I even saw myself as a writer or poet or anything like that. It really kind of evolved over the years. And I probably in my late teens, 19, 20, 21, somewhere in there, that started to take it serious. And I think the driving force there was studying philosophy and spirituality and looking at Lao Tzu and all these other types of writers. So I did the whole Black history thing, you know, but I still wasn't seeing myself as that kind of a writer, you know, officially. But then getting into the philosophers and seeing how they were expressing themselves, and I'm like, okay, so I'm doing the same thing. You know, I have my own path here. And that's, like you said, that's when it got me. It's like, I have something to say. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. It wasn't about the writing so much as I have a means of expression, you know, and I became that. Now, as far as your the development goes, I mean, you mentioned books, so talk about that a little bit.
Well, that, oh man. So I would say around 96, that's where I had the aspiration to write a book of poetry. But, you know, a lot of life events, I was going through a lot at those times, personally, just a young man trying to find his way, trying to find his identity, and with all negative influences surrounding him. I came from a broken home, raised mostly by my mother, who raised, you know, three boys. So you can imagine in a household like that. So I kind of was figuring it out along the way. I was an introvert in a lot of ways. And, but I had this desire in me, and I knew it was definitely, God trying to direct me on the path that he chose for me. Because it was that constant voice inside of me that said, you know, you need to do this. And so that 96 was the year that I wanted to do it, but life happened, struggles, self-doubt, depression, all those fear got in the way. So it wasn't until fast-forwarding till about 2013 that I got reconnected with that. Prior to that, it was probably one of the darkest moments in my life, because I found, you know, through my journey, that when you're not doing what is in your heart, when you're not doing what is the fire that burns inside you, it's going to take a toll on you. One of my favorite motivational speakers is Les Brown, and he says that, you know, if you're not following your passion, it's a slow death. And that's truly what it was for me. And God used poetry to bring me back and say, no, this is what I have for you, and watch where it takes you. And so in 2013, I had this question, well, how, you know, it's going to take a lot of money. It's going to, you know, there's a lot of steps involved. And I said, you know what? I'm just going to just search for the information. And wherever it leads from that point on, that's where I'm going to go. You know, it'll all fall into place. And when I had that change in mind frame, that's where the door started open. It didn't cost a lot of money. It cost a fraction of the cost that I had in my mind. I ran into people that wanted to help me along the way and took me through the process. So in 2014, I established my own company, because I needed a company to distribute my book from, as a self-published author. And all these things started falling into place and making sense. And before you know it, in 2015, I published my first book of poetry. And when one experience that really blew my mind is, it's a funny story. I get an order from my website, and it's from Richmond, Virginia. And I was like, oh, wow, Richmond, Virginia. You know, I got family in Richmond. And it was from, a relative, but she used her real name. I never knew her real name. I was so used to her nickname as Aunt Gina, but Aunt Regina. And so when I got the order, you know, I went to my mother and I was like, who is this? I think it's one of our family members, but I'm not sure. She was like, boy, that's your aunt. But that meant the world to me, because, you know, the hardest thing to do when you're doing anything you know, starting a business or anything, to get family support is one of the hardest things to get. And to get that from, you know, from one of my distant relatives, it like blew my mind and say, okay, this is for real. This, yeah, this is, you know. And then when I got that order from Compton, USA, then I was like, wow, I have truly arrived. And it's been a beautiful journey. The book has been, it's called Beyond the Event Horizon. It's a poetic diary. It merges my two loves of poetry and science. But what makes this book different from the typical poetry book is most poetry books, it's kind of left up to you to decipher what the words are saying to you. I give you that information. I give you an inside look to what was going on with me at the time through the stages in my life. You get to know my mind frame, what was influencing me at that time. You get all of that, so you have a clear understanding of what the words mean. And I've been getting a lot of good feedback and people that are inspired by my work, and it's just a testament of that's what you know, that what the words were for, was to inspire people, was to, you know, have people look at life a little differently than the way that they have either experienced it or seen it.
Great. That's a great story. I like the way you told the story, but then the book reflects your story.
Yeah.
That's what I picked up.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
I couldn't have been better done. I mean, it was really well said the way you pulled that together. All right. One quick question. What would you feel would be your greatest victory?
I would do well, the greatest victory. Ooh, that's a very good question. Cause there's been so many, since I've been pursuing my passion, but I would say the first, when I got that first order of books and it was like, I have, you know, it's here, it's finally here. It's finally manifested right here. And to hold that book, and then to give that book to my first patron, that, you know, life-changing, you know, it was that moment where all that hard work came to fruition.
Great. On that note, we're going to take a break, and we'll be right back after this.
Welcome back to The American Dream. I now present to you Beyond the Barriers with Stanley L.
Whether you're raising a family, advancing a career, building a business on a mission from God, victory lies beyond the barriers. Mankind has demonstrated the capacity to overcome trial after trial, age after age. Nothing seems to be able to stop us, yet we sometimes seem to feel our destiny is doomed. There is no doom for mankind on this earth unless you accept it into your feelings. Even then, remember that you have absolute control over what you feel. So long as there is one of us who feels their mastery over the conditions of the outer world, there is no doom, only glory. For the glory of one person with the fierce determination becomes a magnet of power to draw us all up into the perfection of a new age. That age shall come, and it will come with great ease and peace. It will come with grace and happiness. There is only victory for those who know through experience what they have overcome. Look over your life's experiences. Note that all that you have pursued and attained. Notice the challenges you've met. And remember all the barriers that have served to bring you where you are today. I am the strength, the courage, the power to move forward steadily through all experiences, whatever they may be, and to remain joyous and uplifted, filled with peace and harmony at all times, by the glorious presence which I am.
The American Dream. Reality on Rowan Radio, 89.7 WGLS FM, with host Stanley L.
I believe in the United States of America as a government of the people, by the people, for the people, whose just powers are derived from the consent of the governed, a democracy and a republic, a sovereign nation of many sovereign states, a perfect union, one and inseparable, established upon those principles of freedom, equality, justice, and humanity, for which American patriots sacrificed their lives and fortunes. I therefore believe it is my duty to my country to love it, to support its constitution, to obey its laws, to respect its flag, and to defend it against all enemies, everywhere, forever.
The 14th Principle of Liberty states, life and liberty are secure only so long as the right of property is secure.
And that concludes the American Dream. I'd like to thank you, our listeners, for sharing your time and attention. I'd like to thank this inspiring gentleman, James. It's interesting, you know, when we have various personalities come on the show, some creative, some entrepreneurial, some moms, some pops, you know, some, you know, we get a little bit of everybody. And the hope is that their stories will inspire people. And what makes this particular show so unique is that the motivational basis behind your writings are to do just that. And I just love the way it came across and how talking about your book, you're telling that story and evolving into the book that does just that, you know, that's there to inspire. And I'm really looking forward to seeing some of your work. I have to maybe get your book, huh? You know, but if you can, if you have a short piece, I'd like to maybe share some of that with the audience.
Definitely. This is a piece that I originally wrote for myself, but I realized that the words are for everyone. I had this question of, what if being poor was a person? And what would that person say to us? So I created this piece called Mr. Poor. You know me, your parents know me, but you walk around here like you've outgrown me, like you can out-income me. Look at your bank statement. You don't have a pot to pee. You let people in the same position you are tell you how to be. You're so silly. I mastered the math. All I have to do is take away your dreams to dictate your path, tell you, you don't have a craft, you don't know how to make people laugh, you can't rap, you can't sing, you'll never make the NBA draft. You should be happy with what you have. But like that little girl in the AT&T commercial, we want more, we want more. Gotta have that house you can't afford. Gotta have that credit score. But the wealthy pay in cash, they never meet me, Mr. Poor. You're still pretending like you don't know me. I'm that 4% inflation rate that is preventing you from getting ahead. I'm that Medicaid budget cut that is preventing you from getting your meds, meaning you're dead in the water two ways. All it takes for you to be poor is two pays because you haven't saved for those rainy days. And even if you win the lottery, you'll be broke tomorrow because you haven't changed your ways. Because you would rather have stuff now than be content today. Pay with things with plastic. Make you think you really need one just in case things get drastic now. You're in serious debt living in your parents' attic. You're a brand name fanatic. You're shopping at the mall every payday attic and think all your problems will be solved if you vote Democratic. But the Republicans are the same joke in a different smoke. The law of supply and demand have you all in the same boat like the ones your ancestors came in. And you promote me to everybody you know without me even lifting a pen. Never heard of living below your means. Never heard of living on rice and beans. Gotta have the latest trend. Gotta have this season's jeans. The funny thing is, I'm your enemy and you don't even know it. God can give you a $1 blessing, but you'll just bury it in the ground instead of growing it. They call me Mr. Poor. Thank you.
Wow.
Thank you. Right. Wow is right. God bless you for that. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank
Carlton, you want to wrap it up?
Sure. This has been the American Dream on Rowan Radio 89.7 WGLS FM. As always, have a great week, everyone.
American, the beautiful.